welcome to this long weekend that may or may not feel all that different for some of you watching today, but it's still a celebration because today Canadians join other Commonwealth countries in celebrating Victoria Day weekend. And Christians, well, we celebrate Pentecost. It's the birthday of the church through the giving of the Holy Spirit. Whether or not you're getting the hot dogs and hamburgers ready for the barbecue, or the potato salad ready for a picnic in the backyard, we hope that somehow today together will bring a spirit of refreshment along with a fresh taste of the goodness of God that will see us through the days ahead. After all, this is the day the Lord's made. Let's rejoice. Let's be glad in it. Let's pray. Thank you, Lord, for this new day and for the possibilities it presents to know you and to make you known to those around us, observing you through the living of our lives. Open our ears to your word today, that in it we may see Jesus and give you the glory. In his name we pray. Amen.
Good morning. Today's Old Testament reading comes from Psalm 104, 24 to 35. O Lord, how manifold are your works! In wisdom you have made them all. The earth is full of your creatures. Yonder is the sea, and great and wide. Creeping things innumerable are there, living things both small and great. There go the ships, and the Leviathan that you formed to sport in it. These all look to you, to give them their food in due season. When you gave to them, they gather it up. When you open your hand, they are filled with good things. When you hide your face, they are dismayed. When you take away their breath, they die and return to their dust. When you send forth your spirit, they are created, and you renew the face of the ground. May the glory of the Lord endure forever. May the Lord rejoice in his works. Who looks on the earth and it trembles? Who touches the mountains and they smoke? I will sing to the Lord as long as I live. I will sing praise to my God while I have being. May my meditation be pleasing to him, for I rejoice in the Lord. Let sinners be consumed from the earth, and let the wicked be no more. Praise the Lord, O my soul. Praise the Lord. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Thank you. We know that the whole creation has been groaning in travail together until now. And not only the creation, but we ourselves, who have the first fruits of the Spirit, groan inwardly as we wait for adoption as sons, the redemption of our bodies. For in this hope we were saved. Now hope that is seen is not hope, for who hopes for what he sees? But if we hope for what we do not see, we wait for it with patience. Likewise, the Spirit helps us in our weakness, for we do not know how to pray as we ought, but the Spirit himself intercedes for us with sighs too deep for words. And he who searches the hearts of men knows what is the mind of the Spirit, because the Spirit intercedes for the saints according to the will of God. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
I have a graduation picture of Braylin tucked away in the pocket of my wallet, and I have another one as well. It's an old black and white photo of me around 8 years of age, standing next to my mom and dad on a trail in Point Pelee National Park. Those, along with others, take me back to significant events shared with special people, people who've touched my life, people who continue to add blessing to my days. I have albums and souvenirs at home as well that remind me of people and places that continue to influence me in incredible ways. And my guess is you have some of those too. Photos at home or on your phone or computer that display the faces of people you want never to forget. And we all have them. We like to keep the faces and images of those who mean the most to us close to us. And yet the best image we have as Christians, perhaps, doesn't display the face of the one person we want most to remember. The cross. It's the universal symbol of our faith, but there's nobody on it. The faith that we have is not tied to a static image from long ago. It's connected to a dynamic presence that indwells our lives and infuses us with a power that's changed our future. That empty cross helps to remind us all of Jesus' teachings and miracles and healings and everything that happened after Jesus' resurrection. That empty cross is full of meaning. And the book of Acts says that Jesus gave many convincing proofs that he was seen, risen, and alive after his death on that cross. And rather than give in to nostalgic longings to go back to the good old days, Jesus sends his disciples forward as well, forward into the thick of life, accompanied by the Holy Spirit. In John 14, verse 18, Jesus makes this promise. He says, "I will not leave you as orphans." Some of you know what that feels like. Neither your mom or dad are alive today, and you know what it feels like to be orphaned. It doesn't matter how young or old you are, the feeling sweeps over you. You're no longer the next generation. You're it. Those you used to seek wisdom from or guidance and love from, they're gone. You're on your own. But that's not how Jesus leaves his followers. He said, "I will not leave you as orphans." In fact, he gave us another promise as well in Acts chapter 1, verse 8. He said, "You will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you, and you will be my witnesses to the ends of the earth." In his book, Spirit Rising, Jim Cimbala says that the Christian religion is hopeless without the Holy Spirit. As wonderful as that statement sounds, I'm not all that sure that we're living as if we believe it. The Christian religion is hopeless without the Holy Spirit. Do we really count on the power Jesus tells his followers is here for every one of us? I mean, how often do we wait upon the Spirit to evidence his power in our lives or extend his passion through our own faith? It's so easy to let the darkness of our difficulties overwhelm us, even with Jesus' promise. Why don't we, to use the words of Emily Dickinson, dwell in possibility? The early church was certainly aware that it was hopeless without the Holy Spirit. They would never have moved beyond simply knowing about Christ's resurrection to actually sharing it courageously with others, knowing that it would bring rejection and the loss of friendships, and for some, even death. Without the influence of the Holy Spirit, they would never have stepped out of their comfort zone, or perhaps even left home. The early church was made up of simple men and women. They weren't always particularly courageous. I mean, they fled when Jesus was arrested. Some denied knowing him when invited to testify for him. They were the least likely to be put in charge of a Christian enterprise. And yet, after the events of Acts 2, when the Holy Spirit is poured out, those same nobodies, well, suddenly they were transformed. They squished into each other's homes, reading by candlelight, breaking bread together, and quietly as well as boldly praying together as if their lives depended on it, because actually they did. The one thing they all possessed was the power of the Holy Spirit. They knew that without the Spirit, it would be hopeless, all of it, their faith, their futures, their lives, without Christ's Spirit to make it possible. The one thing they all possessed that enabled them to dwell in possibility as the dark clouds of persecution gathered around them was the Holy Spirit in them. Hope is not wishful thinking. It's not saying to someone, "Don't worry, things are bound to get better." I mean, that's not how Christ comforts those in difficulty. And it's not how we should comfort those going through tough times either. Because no one knows whether tomorrow will bring brighter days or darker clouds for anyone. Christ comforts his followers not with a word, but with the living presence of his Spirit. These past months have seen their share of pain and suffering. Young families are feeling it. Healthcare workers and nurses and doctors, they're exhausted by it. School teachers and students, small business owners, they're all affected by it. The elderly and those in nursing homes, they've experienced it. People the world over, from the largest cities to the most rural locations, have lost loved ones. If we tried to put into words all our longings and groanings, it would likely be a very, very long list. And so today's text is particularly timely. We know that the whole creation has been groaning in labor pains until now. And not only the creation, but we ourselves. If it feels like all creation is groaning for a better world, it is. We are not alone in our waiting, our praying that the world that we live in will one day soon find relief. Relief from COVID, from racism, from bigotry, from violence, from death itself. As Paul says in Romans chapter 8, verse 23, we wait for redemption. We ourselves who have the first fruits of the Spirit groan inwardly while we wait for adoption, the redemption of our bodies. For in hope, he says, we were saved. I'm not saying that suffering always produces hope, and yet hope, it can't emerge apart from suffering. Pentecost Sunday rejects the kind of cheap, shallow hope that many peddle and prop themselves up with. Christian hope rejects Pollyanna thinking that it will all get better tomorrow. It also rejects the pessimism that sees the worst in every situation. Hope which is seen is a limited hope. Its reach ends at what we can accomplish through human effort alone. Biblical hope extends beyond our reach and vision. It lays hold of God's vision for the future. It extends our reach through the work of the Spirit. Keep in mind that Christian hope requires endurance as well. Before the passage we read are these words from verse 18. The suffering in this present time, well, they're not worth comparing with the glory about to be revealed to us. We need to be truthful about the pain that we and others are feeling, the struggles we in the world are enduring, the sorrows, that we and our friends are absorbing. It's scriptural to groan and sigh in the face of hardship while trusting that God is going to use us and others to help redeem the world that God created, the world that God continues to love into wholeness. In his sermon, Shattered Dreams, written from within a Georgia jail, Martin Luther King Jr. encouraged his church with these words. He said, God's creative power is not exhausted by this earthly life, nor is his majestic love locked within the limited walls of time and space. Christian faith makes it possible for us to absorb the most intense pain without abandoning our sense of hope. Peter Story, a bishop in South Africa, in his book, With God in the Crucible, he talks about the great nevertheless of God. We may live in difficult times. Nevertheless, God is guiding creation through the pains to a future fulfillment of promise. We do not see the hope that we hold to. Nevertheless, it is this hope that saves us and for which we're given patience to endure. The Spirit is not always as visibly active in the church as we might desire, and nevertheless, the Spirit is unceasingly attentive to our pleading, to the point of bringing our prayers to God when we have no words. We may not know what God has in store for us. Nevertheless, the Spirit knows the mind of God and leads us toward the will of the one who made us for God's own purposes. If God is in something, no obstacle can block the great nevertheless of God. Hope makes sure that suffering does not have the last word. It's God who has the final word. And it is in this hope that we are saved. Amen.
My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly trust in Jesus' name. Built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly trust in Jesus' name. Christ shall come with trumpet sound. Oh, may I then in him be found, dressed in his righteousness alone, faultless to stand before the throne.
Would you bow with me in prayer? Let's pray. O God of rain-soaked mornings and of flowers which open themselves in expectation in the radiance of the shining sun, today we open ourselves to you, Lord, for we too are expectant of new possibilities offered through your Son. Create in us amid the downpour of difficult circumstances that hope that does not disappoint, that faith that looks forward and extends our reach. Lord of new beginnings and fresh starts and second chances, direct us by the promise and presence of your Spirit to a new beginning this day, to a fresh start where needed. Displace our self-doubt with renewed hope through a second chance born in Christ's love for all listening today. We pray for all those struggling for meaning, striving amid exhaustion, or living without purpose. By the gift of your Spirit, motivate them, O God, toward the accomplishment of something that grants joy to their soul and offers an act of care to someone else. Repurpose us for your glory, O God, that our troubles and temptations would give way to lives tuned to your voice in anticipation of yet another miracle fashioned out of the chaos, creating newness of life for someone this day. Like that first Pentecost of your church, blow upon us this day. Blow your Spirit into our lives in ways which will unleash us from this world and fasten us to your relentless love for this world. Rescue those in need, be they grieving the loss of family or friends, battling cancer or COVID or some other illness, or simply needing a reminder that they are not alone, but held by you in the grip of grace. Forgive us our sins and lead us in the way of salvation. For we pray this through Christ our Lord. Amen. And now may the God who breathed life into creation be your delight. May Jesus Christ give hope to your dreaming, and may the Holy Spirit, your advocate, set your heart ablaze with a passion for peace, and may God grant you progress and joy in the faith. Amen.
I need thee, oh, I need thee, every hour. Oh, bless me now, my Savior. I come to thee.
Every hour I need.
say.